Good morning. Welcome to our traditional Church at Home edition. My name is Pastor Andy Roberts, and I'm one of the associate pastors here at Lake Highlands United Methodist Church. And a little bit later this morning, you will hear from our senior pastor, Reverend Jill Jackson Sears. If you're just checking out Lake Highlands United Methodist Church, we would invite you to check in on our website, lhumc.com/online-worship. You can also get more information about our church by texting the word LOOP to 214-617-1350. And after you do that, you will begin to receive information about our church via text message. If you're joining us on YouTube or Facebook, we would invite you to take a couple of moments to share any prayer requests you might have, as well as greet one another in the comments. We want to tell you about a few things that are happening in the life of our church. We have Wednesday night live prayer every Wednesday at 6:30 p.m. on Facebook. And so if you have liked our page on Facebook, it'll just come right up for you right at 6:30 p.m. Feed Lake Highlands is still receiving lots of donations for food during this time. And so you can drop all that off at the New Room between the hours of 10 a.m. and 2 p.m. You can find out the suggested donated items on our website, lhumc.com/FLH. They're also hosting a food drop-off at Shady's Burgers, which will last until November 16th. And if you drop off a grocery bag full of food, you will get a free fried pickle. So you don't want to miss that. Be sure to turn in that bag of food. Our youth will be hosting a shredding event on November 14th and from 9 a.m. until 1 p.m. This event will benefit our youth's summer mission trips. And so while you have the opportunity to sort of get rid of maybe some clutter in your house, at the same time, you can support our youth going on mission this summer. So it's a worthy cause to be a part of. We're so glad that you're worshiping with us this morning. Would you join me in our call to worship? O God, have mercy on us. In your mercy, make us clean from our sins. Wipe away every failing and make us new in your sight. Restore us, deliver us, and recreate us, Lord. Join me in our opening prayer. Lord God, we sometimes wonder why our lives take the paths they do. We seem to find ourselves in all sorts of situations we had never envisioned, and we wonder what you're doing with us. Keep close to us, we pray, and give us the faith to trust you for whatever happens. Then in your providence, show us more of your glory and grace so that we may be encouraged and praise you forever. Amen. Would you join me in our affirmation of faith? Christians, what do you believe? I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. The third day he rose from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. We love to lift up the great things that God is doing in the life of our church. So this morning, even as you're watching this video, we're giving away Bibles to our third graders in our Relate worship service. We cherish the Word of God in our church, and we're so honored to have the opportunity to be able to give this great inheritance of the Bible to our third graders so that they can grow and be enriched and learn more and more about the ways of Jesus and how to follow him in their daily lives. So I hope that you'll keep our third graders in your prayers as they begin this journey of faith. We also want to celebrate this past Saturday night, Halloween, that we had a trunk-or-treat event in our church parking lot, a drive-by Halloween event, and it was just such an amazing time together where we got to give out so much candy to so many folks from our community. It was far beyond anything we imagined and expected in this crazy 2020 year, and so thankful for all of our volunteers and, of course, Jennifer Weldon, our children's ministry director, who put it all together to make it happen. It was such a blessing to be together. We'd invite you now, if you could take a couple of moments and give to our church. The easiest way to do that is to go to our website, lhumc.com/give, or you can also write a check and send it in to the church office. Thanks in advance for your generosity.
Our scripture reading today comes from the book of Hosea, chapter 11, verses 1 through 9. I invite you to read along in your Bible. When Israel was a child, I loved him, and out of Egypt I called my son. The more I called them, the more they went from me. They kept sacrificing to the Baals and offering incense to idols. Yet it was I who taught Ephraim to walk. I took them up in my arms, but they did not know that I healed them. I led them with cords of human kindness, with hands of love. I was to them like those who lift infants to their cheeks. I bent down to them and fed them. They shall return to the land of Egypt, and Assyria shall be their king, because they have refused to return to me. The sword rages in their cities. It consumes their oracle priests and devours them because of their schemes. My people are bent on turning away from me. To the Most High they call, but he does not raise them up at all. How can I give you up, Ephraim? How can I hand you over, O Israel? How can I make you like Admah? How can I treat you like Zeboim? My heart recoils within me. My compassion grows warm and tender. I will not execute my fierce anger. I will not again destroy Ephraim, for I am God and no mortal, the Holy One in your midst, and I will not come in wrath. The word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. Let us pray. Most holy Lord, open our hearts and minds by the power of your Holy Spirit, that as the scripture is read and your word is proclaimed, we might hear with joy what you say to us today. And may your Holy Spirit move in our hearts and minds, transforming us to love like you. We lift up this prayer in Jesus' holy name, and all of God's people together say, Amen. When I was a little girl, we lived in a home that was right next to the church building. And on one particular day, like lots of little kids, I was bored. And so in my boredom, I decided to go outside and just kind of wander around and find something to do. Well, I wandered towards the entrance to the church office, and near that door was a little flower bed. And I noticed that someone had planted hot pink periwinkles in the flower bed. Well, on that day, I did something that was rather out of character. I sat down on the edge of that flower bed, and I picked every single hot pink bloom off of every single flower. It did not take long for my destructive behavior to be discovered. I don't know if I confessed it or if someone confessed it for me, but it was found out. And I had to suffer the consequences of that action. I had to go to the person who had planted those beautiful hot pink periwinkles and tell them what I had done. I was so embarrassed. I was horrified. But the good news is that I was not kicked out of the church for that action. I wasn't loved any less. In fact, I was told over and over and over again by that church how much God loved me. In spite of my bad decisions, in spite of my sin, God loved me. That's the first time I really remember experiencing both justice and mercy. And looking back, I'm so grateful for it. In our scripture reading today from the book of Hosea, we hear about the justice and mercy of God, and it comes through the prophetic words given from God to the prophet Hosea. And what's interesting about Hosea is we really don't know much about him. We don't have much at all. In fact, the only thing we know about him can be found in the first verse of the book. He's the son of Beeri. That's all we know. And yet, in spite of that lack of information, God gives us a very startling and convicting word through this relatively unknown prophet. If you've been reading through this book, through our year-long reading plan, you know that at the beginning of the book of Hosea, God compares the nation of Israel to an unfaithful wife who has broken her marriage covenant and is falling into the arms of others looking for safety and security in countries such as Egypt and Assyria. The covenant that was established by God between God and Israel is broken. And with that broken covenant comes consequences. Consequences for the actions of the nation. Consequences that is seen lived out in the relationship between the people as well as their relationship with God. If we look all the way back in chapter 4, verses 1 through 3, we hear about what those consequences look like. There's no faithfulness or loyalty and no knowledge of God in the land. Swearing, lying, and murder, and stealing, and adultery break out. Bloodshed follows bloodshed. Therefore, the land mourns, and all who live in it languish. With this broken covenant, there are consequences that cause the people to cry out in pain against God and against one another. But by the time we get to chapter 11, the tone of this prophecy begins to change. As we see God speaking through Hosea, but in a first-person narrative, God talks about God's relationship with Israel as being one between parent and child, a very loving parent, by the way, who cares for his strong-willed, wayward child. Listen to the way God speaks. When Israel was a child, I loved him. And out of Egypt, I called my son. So God reflects on this covenant relationship that he has with Israel. How much God loved him from the very beginning. How God remembers the way that he led his people out of slavery in Egypt. But even then, God also remembers the way that God's people continue to sacrifice to idols offering incense to foreign gods. Even though God taught Israel how to walk, how to become independent and strong. Even though we have this beautiful image of God as that loving father leaning down with cords of love and human kindness, holding Israel by the hand, even bending down cheek to cheek, expressing tender love towards Israel, they act out in rebellion. They return to the land of Egypt, allowing Syria to be their king. The consequences of this action causes pain within the nation. Hosea says it in this way, the swords rage in their cities. There is pain. And we can hear God's heart breaking. By the time we get to verse 8, listen to what God says. How can I give you up, Ephraim? Now, Ephraim is often a synonym for Israel. And looking at the map, it's really kind of the heart of Israel. It's the central part where the major cities and places of worship are. God says, how can I give you up, Ephraim? How can I hand you over, O Israel? How can I make you like Admah? How can I treat you like Zeboiim? My heart recoils within me, and my compassion grows warm and tender. It's like we're getting an inside moment into a conversation that God's having with himself. He's struggling on how to handle this broken covenant relationship with Israel. He doesn't want to treat them like Admah and Zeboiim. Now, you may be wondering where those places are. If you look back to the destruction of Sodom and Gomorrah, they were also cities in that region that were destroyed as well. God doesn't want that. God doesn't want total destruction and demise. God only wants good things for his rebellious, wayward child, the one whom he has always loved. We hear the summary in verse 9. I will not execute my fierce anger. I will not again destroy Ephraim, for I am God and no mortal. The Holy One is in your midst. While God could in one word, destroy everything. Just wipe it out. God doesn't work that way. God's sense of justice is not our sense of justice. The heart of God is one of justice and mercy. God loves God's people enough to allow them to make their choices and suffer the consequences from that, but ultimately they are always welcome home. I know there are many parents and people who have experienced relationships where they have loved ones, people they've cared for, just wander off, break that relationship. And there are all kinds of reasons why that happens. A part of us on the inside wants that other, the one who's wandered off, to suffer the consequences, to feel that tough love, but not to the point of their demise. We love them too much for that. And so we can hear the struggle of what's happening in God's heart, where anger and justice and our love and compassion, they all collide in the heart of our soul. That's what seems to happen here for God. You can hear the anger and frustration in the prophecy, and at the same time, you can hear the tender love that God has for his people. In fact, as we continue in the scripture reading, you find that God makes the comment, you know, they will come back, they will be trembling like little birds, but I will welcome them home. It is no surprise, really, that Jesus also tells a story about the heart of God and tells the story in Luke chapter 15 in terms of God as that father who hears from his youngest son, the younger son who comes to him and says, Dad, I'd like my half of the inheritance and then I'm going to head out of here because I'm going to take this half of the money and I'm going to go to another place where I'm sure there are better things waiting for me. Because the grass is always greener on the other side, right? I'm going to take my half in the inheritance. I'm going to go. And amazingly, the father doesn't stop him. The father doesn't even argue with him. Instead, the father gives his son half of the inheritance and lets the son leave. And he does. The son goes off into that foreign country, and we're told that he squanders it in dissolute living. Before he knows it, all of the resources are gone. A severe famine hits the land. And he's now having to work for a pig farmer. And while he's feeding the pigs, he looks at all the pods and it makes him hungry because he's so hungry. He would love to eat what the pigs are eating. But no one cares. No one cares about him. No one loves him there. Then he remembers his father. He thinks about what it would look like to come home. In fact, he even starts rehearsing his apology, thinking about exactly what he would say to his dad. He starts walking home, but he doesn't even realize that the whole time he's been gone, his father's been looking out on the horizon, hoping and praying to see his son. The whole time the son has been gone, his father's had the front porch light on. The whole time he's been gone, his father has been eagerly awaiting and hoping for his return. No matter how far we may wander, no matter how far we may go, God is always ready to welcome us home. Because that is the very heart of God. No one knew the heart of God better than Jesus. For Jesus was the heart of God incarnate in the flesh. Jesus showed us what the love of God looks like in the way that he taught about the kingdom of heaven. In the way he healed those who were sick, both physically and spiritually. In the way that Jesus was willing to pour out his life on a cross and rise from the grave, giving us life abundant, setting us free from the power of sin. Jesus knows the heart of God because he is the heart of God. God loves us enough to let us make our own decisions, to suffer the consequences that are involved in that, but also to welcome us home whenever we're ready, because he loves us. That's the heart of God. And it's so important, especially on a day like today, that we know the heart of God. We're actually recording this sermon and this worship service on Tuesday, Election Day. And I don't know what's going to happen between this afternoon, Tuesday afternoon, and this coming Sunday. I don't know how the results are all going to pan out. I don't know how people are going to react to this, but there are a few things I do know. I know that there will be some people who are rejoicing and some people who will be very upset. There will be people who feel like winners and people who feel like losers. There will be celebration and there will be heartbreak and everything in between. And so it's important on a time like today for us to know the heart of God and be able to trust the heart of God. Because we have a history, a long history, of trying to put our trust in human people, good people, leaders, elected leaders, who we should respect and who we should pray for. But we also have to see them for who they are. They're human. We cannot look to humans to save us. God already sent a Savior, and his name is Jesus. He will always look out for our best interest, no matter what. And it doesn't matter how far we stray or how far we wander or the mistakes that we make or the number of periwinkles that we pick. He will always welcome us home because he loves us. That's the heart of God. We can trust him. And so I hope in this time, no matter where you may stand, no matter how you may feel, that you are able to rest in the heart of God, who loves you, who welcomes you home. And my prayer is that not only are we able to trust and rest in his grace, but that we are able to share his love and grace with those who may not have a relationship with him in this time, who may wonder what the future has to hold. Introduce them to the heart of God, Jesus himself, who loves us and welcomes us into the home of his heart. Thanks be to God. Let us pray. Merciful God, we praise you, for you are faithful in all times and circumstances. We can trust in you completely. You know how we have a long history of a wandering gaze and trying to put our security in other people and other nations. God, draw our gaze back to you. Help us to turn back to you in all things. Help us to trust in your heart, for you love us. We lift up this prayer in Jesus' name, and all of God's people together say, Amen.
My God is wrathful.
go forth in peace. Having experienced the grace of God in Jesus Christ, we go forward to share his love, his mercy, his goodness with all. We go forth in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, and all of God's people together say, amen. Go in peace.